So you got a good idea what transpired yesterday. There was tens of cupping up a piece of chocolate like a boss on the poker table. I don't know, did you see that, like, firsthand?
That was awesome to watch.
It was beautiful, right?
Yeah.
Beauty. The pure incarnate. Just
boom. Forked it.
So Xixil didn't get much sleep, but I think he'll be just fine for the first game at least, right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, he'll be good. So we've got new groups today. We got like four groups. This is kind of, we're still in the group stage, but this is phase two, so we're down to 16 players. So we randomized the seedings, and they're going to be able to play with new cards today. So you're going to see possibly some of the coolest cards from the first wing. At least we hope so. I mean, I know some cards are a little difficult to make work, like the Ginny. Like, you have to experiment a lot with it to see if it's even worth running at all. But there's a few cards that you can definitely, that have been tried in the past. I know Ty's experimented a lot with the Torch when it was available for a few hours.
Maybe in Freeze Mage.
Right, exactly. And he's pretty hyped about the card. So I know he's not playing today. I don't think he made it through, unfortunately. So we got four groups. We're going to go through the groups themselves. We got Skakov Frodan in Group A with Ignite and Orange. We've got Purple, Freekick, Gaara, Vortex in Group B. Group C consists of RDU, Stan, Sivka, Wreckful, and Firebat. And we've got Powder, Zalay,
wow, that guy's
Super
awesome.
JJ, and Asmodai in the Group D. So the groups are actually, you know, it still can be anyone's game, I think, overall.
You know, no. All the players There's that are no attended, way Oskaka loses in that group.
No? You don't think he's going to lose to Frodan? He almost lost to Elky yesterday.
Yeah, Elky played quite well.
Yeah, he played. He actually played insane.
Yeah.
Insane. Literally insane. So.
If he wins against Elky, how would he lose against anyone in that group?
Frodan plays Secret Paladin too. And we saw what Elky did. So I don't know. Anything can happen. 3-0 Oskaka as Frodan.
Maybe 3-1.
Oh man, that'd be good. That'd be a good day.
I don't think Oskaka makes it out of group.
Okay, how much?
I take it back.
Really? I don't know, man. I feel like Orange has a total chance, right? Like, they're playing.
Of course.
The first match is actually Skaka versus Orange, so we're going to see whether or not he's able to beat your teammate. So, are you telling me you'd rather bet on, like, given the choice, would you bet on Orange or Skaka? Like, the floor is yours.
Well, when you think about what really matters in Hearthstone, and that's hairstyle, I think Orange has a definite advantage. He's got that golden mane, it's really just gorgeous. Skaka, more of a standard hairstyle, not too flashy. I don't think I can give him much chance here.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of like, you know, Control Priest, which is kind of versus, like, Aggro Rogue with Youthful Brewmasters and stuff.
Pirates.
Pirate Rogue, yeah, see? Like, so Orange is like a Pirate Rogue.
Yeah.
Yeah. How do you feel about that, XXL?
I mean, just go face. Pirates are good at that.
Yeah. So you agree then, Orange is going to win.
Oh, he has more pirates than Oskaka, then sure.
Yeah,
sure. And the thing is, Oskaka's face is also, you know, it's easier to target, I guess. You just, like, punch it really fast, because he doesn't pay attention, really. He's too focused on the game. Just, like, come from the side, just punch it. I'm sure Orange would be going for a low blow. So, deck-wise, do you expect these guys to have changed their approach at all? Or, like, I know Zalay, you're playing today, so, like, have you changed anything, really? Not, I don't want to know the classes, but, like, have you had time to really experiment with some of the new stuff? Or was it, like, too last minute?
Well, it's not just the new stuff. It's also just throwing people off. Like, in a situation like this, it's really good to change up, like, your hunter traps, for instance. So that anyone who scouted you and they're playing around the old traps and, surprise, bear trap, let's go.
Yeah. The dark trap didn't come out yet, I don't think, right? No. Did it the new Hunter Trap?
No.
I don't think it has.
I don't know.
Yeah. So, I mean, it kind of makes sense, I guess, just the usual stuff. You don't want to be too predictable. I didn't see Orange really change anything, but I know the players have been, like, discussing a lot. Like, they keep kind of going in caucus and just kind of talking to each other about what they would do for the following day. So even though it's kind of a laid-back event, for all that's worth, players are still taking it pretty seriously.
$10,000 is a lot of money.
Yeah, so it's kind of intense. And also, you know, just the swag points. I mean, Frodan got a few swag points yesterday.
A lot of swag points. I gotta say, I wasn't that surprised to see him win.
Oh,
like,
God.
You watch him commentate, he obviously understands a lot of Hearthstone. So if he's taking it seriously, he should do pretty well.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it just kind of follows. I know some people didn't really talk about the game too much because they didn't have to play on the following day. You know, 6-0 actually just got completely hammered.
Not that drunk.
What? Yeah, not that drunk. Not as drunk as Purple, I guess.
I was fine.
Yeah, you were fine. You were totally fine. I know he loved me.
At various points, you could stand up. It was good. Not all of them.
I know what you're talking about. That's fine.
Yeah, fine. You don't remember. It's okay.
Surrender was fine as well. Everybody was pretty fine yesterday.
Yeah.
And pretty fine. Pretty damn fine.
Just fine.
Yeah. So,
Oskaka having played Pliskon and just getting back from America, I'm pretty sure he didn't have time to prepare more than one lineup, so I'm really confident he will play the same lineup as yesterday.
Frodan could have completely abused this. I know Frodan was in, like, shadowy discussions with Gaara in the back of downstairs. Like, they were talking about what was going on. I figured, like, something really important is going on there. And then
They had to submit the decks for this round before the tournament started.
Yep.
Yeah, but they must have talked about, like, what was possible. So, because Frodan didn't expect to make it through. He thought it was a show match. Frodan said, like, literally...
Sold himself short.
Yeah, he did that. But I don't think he expected to beat, like, Dice 3-0 with Secret Paladin. I mean,
we're all playing Hearthstone here. Anything can happen.
Yeah, it's not. It's not a coin flip, of course. Like, the skill does matter. But Frodan is knowledgeable enough that he's not to be dismissed in an event even like this.
Right.
Yeah. All right, so, I don't really know if there's anybody that I would pin on moving on as far as, like, guaranteed thing, because I think all the players there are, you know, they deserve their spot. But it's going to be kind of nice to see them play. So the players are getting ready. I'm not sure if they're ready to start their game, but it would be kind of nice to see it go. So we're still going to have, you know, we're going to be thinning people down today, but it's not going to be the end. Tomorrow is the big playoffs. We'll have 8 players left that are going to be competing in a very easy single elimination bracket, I think, all the way up. So
Nox, give us your 2 picks for every group. Who's making it out?
To make it out of each group?
So first group, Oskaka, Frodan, Ignite, Orange.
I'm going to go Oskaka, Frodan. Group B, I'm going to go...
betting against my teammate.
Well, I don't know. I just really want to see Frodan win.
All right, let me give my picks. Well, I'll give our picks, and then we'll go to the next group. So
yeah,
I'm picking...
Sure.
I'm going to go with Orange, number one, and then I guess Oskaka, number two, world champion.
Okay. Right. I would go with number one, Oskaka, and number two, it's Oskaka.
Okay.
I like that a lot.
All right, Group B, Purple, Frieke, Gaara, and Vortex.
I'd go for Purple, and that's pretty tough, honestly. I know Purple is going through for the 3 other ones. I want to say Vortex, but the Warrior was kind of interesting yesterday, like the very greedy one.
Yeah, I remember that.
So maybe Purple, Vortex, we'll see.
I go with Purple and Gaara.
I agree with 6 on this one. Purple and Gaara are my favorites in that group.
Well, Group C, I'm going to say RDU, Stansivka. RDU, Firebat. Stansivka, Firebat. It's going to be pretty difficult to pick. But either way, the players are starting, by the way. There's Druid versus Hunter. So Oskaka is going to be playing in the aggro Druid we saw him play yesterday. Yeah. I don't know if any cards change. I don't really see that anything came out that would make you change your mind for this deck. But the Hunter deck looks to be...
These are some nice starting hands.
Yeah, a sick starting hand for both players.
You keep that Druid of the Saber?
I think I would. Again, I mean, it's really easy removal against... you might either play it as a threat, or you're able to trigger a trap, like freezing if it comes out.
Okay.
So it's also but able to be used as clutch removal.
You also have Living Roots for that. You can go turn 1 Living Roots, turn 2 Nonasus Aspirant, turn 3 maybe you're looking for something stronger than a 2-drop. You could potentially be playing a 4-drop, hopefully at least.
So you'd be looking for something like Animal Companion, probably Eaglehorn Bow, perhaps.
Yeah, I would play Animal Companion and Druid. That seems good.
Yeah. Very, very good card.
We're talking about, so the Druid Mulligan, I was looking at turn 1 Living Roots, turn 2 Darnassus Aspirant, turn 3 something bigger than the 2-drops, so I was going to Mulligan it. So Coin Creeper to contest the Living Roots.
I'm not sure about the... Like, I don't really know about Druid of Saber being thrown out, because I feel like it's an early game card guaranteed, whereas sometimes... Like, most often, I think you'll pick something worse from this deck than... You do have Leper Gnomes to play on turn, as a 3-drop with your hero power.
So do we quick shot that Aspirant, deny the extra mana?
It's hard not to.
Yeah.
Since you're still ahead on the board, like, by a long shot. Oh man, this old Treant looks too friendly to be punching you in the face.
So, we're hero powering that Haunted Creeper?
Yeah, I guess we just play more dudes.
And we trade our 1 Living Root in to play around Unleash a little bit?
No.
hear from Orange about the Keeper of the Grove?
Well, what can you do about it?
I mean, I might have killed a 1-1 in that case.
Oh,
well,
no, that's 4 damage.
Just like 4 damage to face.
4 damage.
You protect the Huffer.
That's like, and you're that's still like 80% of a kill command.
Yeah, I mean, because you're dealing 8 total if he has to use the face. It's just that if he doesn't have Keeper, then he's using face and you're still dealing 4. Right? And if he has Keeper, then you just lost the 4 anyway. Because you're not getting more out of it.
No, but you get 4 damage if you go face, and 4 damage is probably worth more than the dude on board.
Yeah, but you still get the 4 damage.
So we're taunting up here because of the Shredder.
Yeah.
Don't want to just die to that.
I like it. It's tough not to do.
And as Hunter here, you're looking to set up for a turn 6 high main.
One question, though. Like, with a board like this coming from the Hunter in the following turns, I don't really see how Skaka's going to... Oh my goodness. Okay. It's kind of mild, though.
He played the Scientist before trading the Shredder because of there's 2 cards, right? One that makes the Nurubar Weblord makes Battle Cries more expensive.
Or no, we didn't have. Why did he play the Mad Scientist first?
It's just, yeah.
I mean, if it is...
It's just the 2-2.
It doesn't get the Tuba power, but if it's Knife Juggler, it's pretty good to trade first.
Yeah.
I mean, the odds are the same either way. But I think there's a lot more cards that backfire than don't. Because you look at Explosive Sheep, that's a really big problem. You look at Doomsayer, which is a mild thing. Like, there's a few reasons I think that are going to be worse than Mana Raid. There's like one out that's really bad.
So what you're saying is Orange has misplayed?
No, I think it's not like necessarily a big deal.
It's really minor either way.
Yeah. Oh, man. Actually, Savage Roar looking pretty scary right now with 2 stealth minions. If Oskaka just sits on those until he picks up a Force of Nature.
So...
Do you trade the Scientist?
I think we probably trade, because yeah. Probably a Freezing Trap, and that's pretty good here.
Oh man, I wonder if there's ever going to be a day where the high main is just not played anymore. It's one of those cards that just backs way too much power.
Yeah.
You can play a Cane Golem instead, or a Wolf Rider.
Ooh.
Oh no, Xixo, don't
push
do this
that
to me.
3-4 damage.
Oh no. Please don't. Just don't.
Alright. There's a Snake Trap? Probably not.
Well, I'll have to see, because as you said, he might have shuffled up the traps.
Yep.
If he feels like he has to have the Element of Surprise.
Element of Surprise is a big deal with traps.
Freezing, alright. So there will be a replay, and there's a chance that the assassin gets sniped by the juggle here. That would be a really big deal. If only because it's taking out a minion that can kill something big that you replay later. Face damage is good as well. But, with kill command, feels like it's a... I'm not sure if it's 2-turn lethal. It does look like it, though. It definitely does look like it.
It's definitely 2-turn lethal.
Yeah.
Without defense from the druid. So, we're trading our patient assassin into that juggler.
Yeah, so let's count damage. If there's a Druid of the Claw top deck, which should be the most damage you can draw, it's 17 damage. So there's no out for Skaka in this position.
Yeah, he'd be going to like 19 with the hero damage as well. But that's like with Druid of the Claw, that's assuming it's the best possible outcome. There's no draw, no heal. So there's no chance.
Here with a chance to snipe?
Swipe would do something. Would it? No, wouldn't do much.
You really
unless
need
you have
hour
to trade
after
everything.
That. That's oh my difference. God!
Fell River too late.
Little too late.
Orange had an extremely good curve this game. Oskaka stumbled on turn 3, and that's you fall behind that early. It just snowballs.
No, just a misplay. Not have a sweet drop in time.
Yeah, very big misplay.
Yeah.
Experienced dual player would have played Innovate Fell River in that position.
Yeah.
I can see it. Tice is just like, yeah, it's pretty easy. Although I don't think I've seen Tice play much the Innervate, like I mean the aggro druid variant. I haven't seen him play it that much. Even if though it's a pretty great player, I think Oskaka's played it a lot more than he has. Oskaka might just be the aggro druid master at this point.
Oh, he hasn't played it before this tournament. He didn't practice it.
No.
No.
Zero.
No.
He played a couple of games before Plisscon decided not to bring it to Plisscon and then just didn't play it.
Zero Oskaka. Well,
good old kill command.
That's pretty good.
Could have played more cards
right?
to see more stuff off Fellraver. But I guess it's not.
Dusty was standing.
Yeah.
You might play him again in the decider match later.
On. Like,
hey, never
yeah.
know.
Yeah, there's a chance, right, that they meet each other. If assuming Orange ends up winning, and then he loses, and then he's got to face Oskaka, who goes like really badly. Might happen.
So, who's favorite in aggro druid versus hybrid hunter?
I'm not quite sure. On practice, I went pretty even.
Yeah.
So I will go with that.
That's about it, I'd say,
I guess
too.
It depends how much innovate failure you play.
Okay.
How many explosive traps there are as well. That sounds like something you wouldn't necessarily see too much of nowadays. But it's the type of card that really blows the early game of the Druid out of the... Like, they really can just attack you and get damage in very easily.
Yeah. If you
it's not a huge deal, though, but it's kind of a gimmick.
If you set up explosive trap and rely on it, your opponent can just never attack phase, or at least wait until he has a good board, uses small minions to trade, and then when he procs an explosive trap, Hunter is basically dead already. So
yeah.
I don't think relying on an explosive trap is...
Yeah, Fel Reaver on its own is too big of a threat that you have to play freezing. It's like you're forced to play cards like these against... Like, they still can trigger it with Druid of the Saber, they can trigger it with Druid of the Claw, the Force of Nature as well. So no matter which trap you play against Druid, I feel like nowadays, you're not getting that much of an edge. So not that big of one.
Oskaka likes his entire hand for this mulligan. He brings in Rogue against mid-range Hunter, saps a devastating tempo game against high main, for instance. It's one of the reasons you want to play Rogue against mid-range Hunter.
Yeah, with the sap, though... I mean, the Stranglethorn Tiger, we were talking about this card downstairs a little earlier, at least, with Purple. And we were talking about, you know, this card is not a card that you see everywhere in every single deck. Orange, though, I see him play way more of it than I probably anyone else in Hunter.
He likes it. I mean, it's
insane, right? The way he just always has it.
It's pretty nice against Rogue.
But so is Jungle Panther. Isn't Jungle Panther just better?
Well, it does the, like, Coin, Drake, Prep, Vanna Knives.
But if you're in five.
No, I think the 5 toughness is very relevant.
Yeah, it kills Belcher.
It doesn't just get in for 4 or 5 damage. It's also like a problem that you have to kill.
Yeah, but like 2 turns after you play it, the game should be over either way.
Okay.
No one because you started with Arcane Golems and Wolf Riders, right? So they're already low on health. And then you just play the Tiger and you just keep going face.
Yeah. I get them.
So are we backstabbing that Scientist?
With a hand like this, that's really the question. Because re-daggering up, does it have any merit?
Oh no, you play like faster for sure.
You have to play the minion at least. But the question is, how much do you think there's a Glaivezooka perhaps? Because that's about the only thing that would really punish you, right? Or a juggler plus a 2-drop on the coin. I'm just not sure killing the scientist is necessarily the necessary. But if you really want that freezing trap to be a problem and force the hunter to deal with the Earthen Ring.
He could have sequenced that turn differently to test snipe. Apparently,
yeah, but
not one.
You'd rather get a Shredder snipe and get Milhouse instantly.
Oh, of course. that is better.
Oh no, 6-0. You need to sleep more, or just be this.
Coin Shredder, yeah. Creeper's
like
a little
it.
Too weak. Use your coin.
Easiest Shredder of his life. Or is it?
Picking up a Farseer doesn't feel too bad as Rogue here.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if he's playing two of them. I think we saw two yesterday.
He played two in his Biscon deck, so
right,
quite
exactly.
Likely.
So you think it's just the same lineup? Exactly. I know he said that, him and Entice really didn't have much...
So do you clear this because of oil, or do you take 4 damage?
Oh, there's no way you could trade the... Yeah, you can't trade here.
Told me earlier that Huffer had to go face. I'm going to stand by that statement.
But if you trade, you basically make your Shredder a Huffer.
Ooh.
Oh my god. It's always Huffer.
I feel like Huffer's more about the 4 to the face than it is about the stat line.
Please don't. You know, one day we're going to get like a 2 mana 4-2 a charge, right? It's going to happen, and it's going to give 7 mana crystals to the opponent, and Hunters won't even care. They'll just play it. And then it's going to drop out of the Shredder half the time. Oh, wow. That's a bit tricky, though, because, I mean, you can prep Fan of Knives if that's worth it after popping the Spider. And then you can SI, because you can pop the Shredder that way. So you just attack.
Just close up this turn.
That's
just
it.
Superior.
Yeah.
Okay, so Dr. getting the 5-5 out is better. I thought the SI, because you can clear the entire board, right? Like, you pop the Spider. Oh, no. You still can't kill the... you can pop the Shredder. The only thing you leave up is, like, the 2-drop that comes out. And you still have a 1-1.
But what do you do on turn 6 then? I guess you have a couple of draws and Fan of Knives cycles, so
right.
He's going forward.
We'll see what he does. I kind of like that play, because you really deal with the board in a way that Lothab doesn't. Because even though he might be able to... sure, you're getting a pretty good tempo play by playing Lothab, but he can still trade with it on the board and keep stuff alive, and then follow it up with a 5-drop.
Picks up oil.
Doomsayer. Oh no. Still really good, though.
So next turn, he can prep Oil and Lotheb.
So do you have Knife Juggler and Leash? And you can trade.
Wow, that's a tough question.
Yeah, I guess it's hard to get more than two minions on board from a rogue, huh? So maybe it's the best. Yeah,
unless you wait for the teacher. That would be like the only time where it happens. So that's a very... That's a long shot. But getting the Stranglethorn now...
pretty tempting.
Yeah, I was going to say, because like, there's no way it gets removed, and the only thing you're leaving is a 1-1, which will die to the juggler play eventually.
So. That's the way it gets removed. Rogue has a card that deals damage to all of enemy minions.
Yeah.
So Blade.
You like that?
Fury.
No.
Deal damage to minions? Doesn't sound huntery.
So do we just trade and play Tiger here? Try and set up a Juggler Unleashed for next turn? Seems pretty strong.
I think the point at this, like for Orange at this stage, like he knows his opponent's got another, he's got another Farseer. So he knows he's not going to get like the craziest like amount of healing. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's only 3 extra health, but it's enough that you're not going to be able to rush him down. Like, there's no high main in your hand. You're still vulnerable to sap if you play high main. So Orange is just thinking, I'm going to have to trade for the board, and probably he's going to be relying on the Stranglethorn Tiger to do so, because it's a lot safer to use that Tiger as a trading mechanism than just going for Juggler Unleashed. It gets board wiped just about any time. Okay. Now that's... Now, Blade Flurry can still be played technically, but because there's no spell damage, you wouldn't mind if you played Lotheb here, I think.
So is this like a Lotheb face turn? Just kind of like daring you to race? I don't...
You might just want to trade your Tiger into a Lotheb and play Knife Juggler, a Cane Golem, and hope that the Juggler snipes the 4-1. It is a 50-50, but it's a really huge run.
Yeah, I mean, if you kill the Lotheb, don't you just let the rogue get the aggression?
Not if you hit the Knife Juggler. You get a Cane Golem and Knife Juggler on the board, and clear the opponent's board.
And you're optimistic.
I mean, it is a 50-50, and he basically just wins the game if he hits it, so it might be just worse.
Mm-hmm. Pretty good 50-50.
Yeah.
This play has some merit to it as well, like, trying to be the aggressor is really nice, and getting the Lotheb effect so that the rogue's playing minions this turn into your Juggler Unleash.
So, what is Oskaka doing? I'm pretty sure we will see the Farseer. We will see the weapon and the 4-1 attacking phase. The only question is if Lotheb trades into Tiger or not.
I mean, without Blade Flurry, it's really hard not to go for trades either way, right? Because, like, the amount of, it doesn't even matter that you have the Farseer at this point if you're staring down 10 damage. So there's definitely a trade happening, but the question is whether or not you're going to be able to get it done like easily. Because this, trading away your Lotheb is kind of fine, but you're still left with another 5-5 on the board to deal with.
Yeah, but by trading, you give your opponent one more turn, because if you go to the face, he has to deal with your board, otherwise he's dead.
So, Firebat style.
I mean, Oskaka is going to be Firebat.
Yeah. That Violet Teacher is going to feed, but it's also going to threaten, like, if he attacks with a Lotheb into the Violet Teacher instead of trading, then he's going to feel a little bit scared maybe that you have a Flurry, because then his entire board is gone. But that Juggler.
This game's pretty close.
Yeah, it's just a matter of Blade Flurry, I think, at this stage, because with the Violet Teacher alive, I mean, Orange has a lot of damage next turn, right? You can pull off a roll of 8, so he's going to be one off lethal. So if even a 1 damage stays... That top deck! That is
Orange
insane,
only needs 1 more
and he cursed perfectly with a Farseer, so he's going to be 4 off lethal. That just might be the turn that turned everything around.
But Orange still can pick up lethal here. He has 8 mana, so he can play Wolf Rider, Yusuf Sargent, Quickshot.
Sure.
Okay.
That's not it.
Nope.
yes.
Wow.
So wait,
Flurry.
If you kill the 3-5, I mean, if you kill the Farseer, that is there ever a world in which you can win after that point? Because if you go for the Golem and do that, then you can't play the Savannah. You're still alive technically for one turn, but maybe the high main's enough that the rogue like it will have to.
We never have time to play.
Yeah,
this high
you just can't play this high main ever this game. I don't think.
There's just. There's no way.
You have to Arcane Golem to trade into the Farseer no matter what. But the question, like, what I'm wondering is what you can even get that's going to help you win the game ever. Because the dagger will eventually finish you off.
Well, okay. If we Arcane Golem into the 3-3 and then draw Leeroy, an Abusive Sergeant with hero power, that's lethal, right?
That'd be cool.
So that's our plan.
I just want to see Leeroy come back.
I don't think it's in the deck, but it were.
Oh, no. That's kind of sad, though, for Orange, because it felt like the Tiger on 5. Like, we'd have to go back to that turn and see how much it affected everything, because the 50-50 that Sixo mentioned about, you know, winning the game immediately as a 50-50 from the snipe. You might have said that facetiously.
And the way the game panned out, Orange had a really, really good position.
Flurry was the only thing.
He had Oskaka on one floor to get Flurry, otherwise he would have just won the game. So the way it went, he had like, I don't know, maybe 85% chance to win.
Of winning,
so
extremely good.
Yeah, I think the Deadly Poison, like it was back-to-back Deadly Poison into Blade Flurry, so it had to be like an extra buff from the 4 attack
into the
Flurry. So it had to be these exact 2 draws to wipe the board clean in order to get Orange off the board. So that was actually really clutch from Oskaka.
Yeah, but
so
Orange being the world champion he is, he just has a Blade Flurry every time.
Yeah, it wasn't even hard. Like, it's obviously a Blade Flurry draw. So Orange is trying to beat a Rogue, and he decides Druid's his best bet.
That's how you play the game. Just call the cards. Believe. All right, what do you keep in the Rogue hand here? I feel like Violet Teacher is kind of a problem for Druid to handle.
Yeah.
So that on its own, it's kind of hard to say no to that card.
Yeah, like, he will keep his Teacher, he won't keep Sprint and Tinkersoil. I think he just considers the Farseer, and he keeps it.
Minions are pretty good against Druid.
Gets a Deadly Poison for the Nasus. Quite good.
So turn 2, he kills with Deadly Poison on that or not. Sasperin, turn 3. Oh. Does SI7 change anything?
If you pick up a backstab, it sure does. Where you might prefer to get a 3-3 out instead of going for the deadly. In this case, though, I mean, there might be an argument for going for the minion. I just don't see what it's going to do over just killing the Aspirant right now. Because if you curve into a Shredder right now and you don't have like backstabs to deal with it, it's going to be really difficult.
You almost always kill the Aspirant immediately if you have
exactly.
to do so. Aspirant's almost an argument for mulliganing the Farseer, because it's just like one more card that doesn't kill the Darnassus Aspirant.
I mean, it does kill it.
It doesn't kill it on time.
I mean, you play it, and if he plays the Shredder, you can still, after that, trade your 3-3 into the 2-3, and it's not bad for you. So, I don't
Orange
know.
Has some nice Shade Lotheb synergy here.
Yeah, I was going to say, what's interesting like about this turn is that there was the option of going for Innervate 5-drop into Shade as a 4-drop, into 5-drop as a 5-drop. But he opted to play a little off-curve and maybe just get a 5-drop out for 6 mana by using the Innervate 1 turn later and just get the Shade to get it bigger before that happens.
So, do we just Wrath for 3 and Hero Power this turn? Or before the Farseer, I was thinking maybe like Innervate Azure Drake, setting up for Lotheb plus Shade attack.
You might still do that, because there's a chance that Oskaka doesn't have a good way to enable Eviscerate or to combo it. So, might just take the risk, and even if your opponent can deal with it, you then get a pretty good Lotheb turn regardless.
If he draws Living Roots off the Azure Drake, it'd be insane. Innervate Drake, Living Roots for 3 on your Farseer. That would be some.
I mean, the only thing that punishes you is literally Blood Mage Thalnos Flurry. That would be like the only thing.
It's a pretty
rough
punish.
That'd be really, that would be like a crazy punish. But it's kind of uncommon. Like, you wouldn't expect it to be there necessarily.
Yeah, certainly.
Like, Blood Mage Thalnos in a starting hand, I'm not sure, right? So, like, there's a lot of. Like, the odds of you getting that one legendary that play is pretty slim.
Yeah, having the one legendary and the Flurry,
right.
It's like maybe 1 in 6 or something.
Considering you might not,
not even,
Flurry and roll again anyway. Wow.
Still
rough, man. The backstab SI is. There's the Violet Teacher backstab attack, which is also probably to be considered.
Yeah, I think the Violet Teacher is probably his best odd.
Yeah, I think I like Teacher.
Kind of plays into Swipe, because you can trade your Shade into Teacher and then Swipe the Farseer.
Yeah, it's not the end of the world. It's like a turn 5 Swipe.
So the question is, what are you saying, like, for the Lotheb setup, right? Because this turn basically leads you into Lotheb pretty much no matter what, unless something really comes up.
Mm-hmm.
So what would you like to have? And I feel like the more minion approach, the more minion-centric approach would be the Violet Teacher one, where you go for the Violet Teacher backstab and maybe trade away your dagger.
Right.
And then your Lotheb guarantees a really sick board where the Shade is forced to be unstealthed and then your SI or Eviscerate can take care of it. That would probably be like the... You're forcing the Druid to have Swipe, effectively.
This play also gives the rogue good options against the druid Lotheb turn. You can Thalnos Asai if you don't like your own Lotheb.
I like that. That's really cool. Yeah, the fact that you can curve in a combo play with the SI with the Blood Mage and play Lotheb gives you either a temple play or a removal play, depending on what you need. So it gives you more flexibility than going for the SI immediately. Yeah, that's definitely the right play.
So Orange is in a rough spot here. His hand is Big Game Hunter, Savage Roar, Wildgrowth. None of those cards are likely to be good anytime soon. And he's unable to deal with that teacher.
Yeah, I think the Blood Mage SI is really... I mean, it's looking tempting.
Which one do you play? The one you had from the start of the game or the top deck one?
The top deck. Haven't you learned? The Tilt Factor.
Tilt Factor?
Yeah, it's good.
Oh, I think I just tilted enough after that played Flurry top deck. I don't think he needs to tilt him more at this point.
No, you just push it. Push it further. But there's the risk that at some point you push it so much that the guy just like, okay, this game is ridiculous. I don't care anymore. And then they don't get tilted.
Really tough spot here for Orange.
Yeah, I think he knew that like as soon as the teacher came out and he couldn't answer it right away. That was already difficult.
So this is like trade, taunt up.
But if you trade, you would trade with a Shade into that.
That I was
quite an interesting play.
There is no punish. Like if you kill the Farseer, you're vulnerable to a Flurry play or Blood Mage. You know, Blood Mage, Phantom Knives, Drake, Prep, Phantom Knives. There's a few plays that can kill everything you've got without expending too much on the Rogue's part, but they do involve some combo plays, so it's got to be like a very specific hand.
Yeah, as Orange here, I'm not thinking too much about playing around a lot of things. I'm just trying to find
exactly,
you know, some way that things can actually work out so that I can win this game.
This looks like one, like a really good way, because if... Yeah. There's no punish, like from the Blade Flurry, let's say, then you should be fine. But in this case, with the Eviscerate SI... oh my god. Never mind.
That's kind of gross.
Oh.
That's why Oskaka is the current world champion.
Oh,
yeah,
god.
Wow.
6-0, like 6-0 seems to be stressing that point a lot. I feel like...
Wrath for one on Lotheb.
Yeah, that's good enough.
It's a good start. The problem is...
better pick up
Druid's
something.
Druid's not really going to accomplish much on the board here this turn. Rogue's going to get to develop on an empty board. He has a nice hand to do so.
Keep cycling. That like, Orange needs to find a minion right now that can be played. All right.
Oh, perfect.
That does it. That definitely does it.
Probably taunting. Value the extra toughness.
That's a pretty good card to get. The prep. Now we can play Shredder, Prep, Avis, and SI.
Yeah.
Wow. Pretty good turn.
Yeah, you can kill everything and also have two minions on the board that you know the Druid is basically unable to handle.
World champion right there.
Yep. Meanwhile, Orange's hand
Meanwhile.
It's getting memed, all right.
Oh, God. All right. Perfect.
Shredder positioning. What a god.
He's not playing around the double Flame Tongue if he gets another Shredder. Well, we'll see where he puts the other one, right?
All right. Swipe's a nice card, but...
Too late. It's like two turns late, I think. Maybe three turns even.
Oh, he needed on turn five.
Yeah.
Three turns.
Three turns late.
Not going for Doomsday routes?
Oh my goodness.
I guess it doesn't feel that bad that you're actually going for one percenters yet.
Although this is the type of game that you... Like, you see rogues do that a lot when Druid doesn't get the good... Like, when you get the Aspirant, it's the first start. But if you don't have a follow-up immediately, then it can be a little bit difficult. And the Shade is really slow. Like, it's a slow card to ramp up. And against rogues, if they ever get a turn where they wipe your board, if they get their minions and you don't have, like, a swipe, that's pretty much it. Like, it happens quite frequently.
Yeah. As soon as Rogue sticks a minion starts hitting you with it.
So if you can choose two cards to have on turn 9, Savage Roar Wildgrowth is probably the worst.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe, I mean, double wild growth is still better.
No, yeah, then you can cycle in.
Yeah, you can cycle in.
Double Savage Roar, like, you feel like you're closer to killing them somehow.
Yeah, it's just a feeling, but...
Yeah, well, at least you... Okay.
All right, so there's 9 damage from the rogue right now. If,
right, 10 with the dagger.
Well...
9.
I count 9 with the dagger.
Never lucky.
So the third SI7 agent would be lethal.
Oh my god, that's big. And BGH was just played, right? So and either way, there's only 2 cards, so it's going to be 6-6 anyway. Yeah, that's pretty powerful. Full of the face.
Upstairs.
So what antics does the Druid need to pull off to win this? It's got to be some kind of crazy Doomsayer drop of sorts.
No, he doesn't kill the Shredder, so that can't happen.
I mean, maybe he just plays Ancient of War, 5-10 Taunt.
Right, if he has that in his deck, Dr. Boom would. I mean, assuming something amazing comes out of these Shredders. What is he looking for in his deck here to save himself?
5-10 Taunt could be in there.
All right, that's something. I mean, it reduces Edwin's effectiveness, but you're still dead to it.
Still going like, Doomsayer exactly. Outs here.
You had to try, at least.
Not just Doomsayer,
Explosive Sheep would
Explosive
be better.
Sheep, yeah.
Explosive Sheep's probably a bit better. Oh!
All right.
That is insane!
So a chance we would see Orange as next oh, champion?
He's going to get Sap. No, Skaka just gets Sap off the top. And Sixel's prophecy is confirmed. He is the world champion.
He has one backstep left as well. No, he used both backsteps, so...
It's got to be
probably
Sap.
Sprint.
Sprint Sap.
Yeah.
Annoyatron versus Ancient Watcher. That is insanely good.
That is probably the single best combination that could have happened, right? Well, I mean, aside from, of course, the Explosive Sheep, but it's one of those really rare cases where both Shredders go right for one player.
Yeah.
Oh my god. If...
9 plus 7, 9 plus 8.
I mean, you keep her the Grove, that Edwin, and you can deal with the entire board.
Yep.
And then Iron Beak Owl out of the rogue deck, and the Washer goes face. Oh, that's...
Do we start with a Boombot on the teacher, maybe? Do some Force of Nature trades later?
No, because no matter what the Boombot hits, I guess...
This way you're increasing the chance of Boombot hitting Watcher, which is a bad thing.
Yeah. I guess we don't hit that Watcher.
Well, now Sap doesn't matter. It's got to be Eviscerate off the top. I don't think there's much damage left. Salty Deckhand works as well. Azure Drake could pick up a lethal.
Oil.
And it... Oh! Everything is going wrong right now for Skaka. But the sprint has to be getting a lethal of sorts.
Yeah, so.
There's no more SI, so that won't work. But there's a deadly poison left.
There's a lot of top decks here for Orange.
7, 8, 9, 10. Come on, give me a swipe. Give me a Savage Roar.
Force of Nature, Drew to the Charge. There's a,
I think he's played those. Yeah, he's played both of those, but I think he's got about 4 outs in that deck, if I'm not mistaken.
There's
so.
Like a Savage Roar, a Force of Nature,
one swipe.
One swipe,
and then another Keeper of the Grove.
Oh, wait, he doesn't need anything.
Redraws?
The Boombot.
He has 10 damage and Boombot has 4.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So that's a 1 in 12 right there.
Totally worth.
Oh.
That's not
okay,
what he
so does he go for it? He has to.
He has to, it's no option.
If it works. If
four to the face, 1 in 12.
It
come on, Orange.
Works.
He sports him.
Oh!
What a god!
What? Oh my god!
Who's world champion now?
But granted, though, Oskaka did it that exact thing yesterday to Tice, I believe, by hitting for 4 with a Boombot at the very last moment. What was that?
That game was absurd.
That's awesome.
That was
you.
So crazy.
I don't even...
I had given up on Orange, to be honest, until those Shredders.
Oh, yeah, those Shredders.
That was something.
Annoyatron Watcher into 4 damage Boombot on a 1 out of 12. That is absurd. Well, Hearthstone does what Hearthstone does.
Oskaka looks frustrated.
Yeah, I was going to say, he doesn't seem as calm as he usually does. There's a look of frustration
on
his face.
He's poker face normally.
But he did it yesterday to somebody. So I think
there's the 5-10 we were talking about. That would have been helpful.
He could have drawn it and won from this. Wow, I still can't believe this. All right.
So Oskaka's best option for beating this druid is Freeze Mage.
It's his last deck.
Yeah, that's a problem.
But if he wins, he will also beat the Paladin.
Right, that's going to be... if Oskaka picks this off, he basically gets, I want to say, a free win, but Paladin's a lot easier than pretty much any deck for Freeze Mage right now.
I wouldn't be surprised if he wins this game. It's not looking as bad as you might think.
It's really bad, and I would be surprised. Yeah.
I think so far, I've seen... Freeze Mage winning this matchup twice in this tournament already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, this is not a hyper-aggressive druid, so it's a bit tougher sometimes to push them off the board.
Not having anything to play on the 3 is really bad. You really need Intellect or anything else, like Acolyte, Second Mad Scientist, Loot Hoarder.
How useful is Explosive Sheep as a Freeze Mage against a druid?
It's
like not
shades.
The matchup you put it in for, but...
For Shades, I guess you could always get the one spot removal, mm-hmm. but it's a very minor point. What you usually see, I think, from Explosive Sheep is they end up putting it on the board and leaving it there when there's already minions.
Right.
So that they can set a really good AoE on the following turn with like a bit, maybe 6 damage, Flame Strike, instead of just being 4.
So Orange didn't want to play Keeper that turn. He's saving it for Doomsayer.
Yeah. That's a point of contention amongst... I know some druids prefer to just use it on the Mad Scientist to not let the mage get to the secrets.
Oh, wow.
But the Doomsayer is so easy to just wipe your board.
I think Keeper's such a great answer against Doomsayer. I lean towards saving it.
Oh, for sure.
So, as Kaka announced that Ouch still has his coins, so against druids, you don't want to let them get to 7 mana early. So he has to play probably either Doomsayer to prevent the 7 drop or Frostbolt on Nidanasus.
It's too early to let the 7 drops fall. Whether it's Ancient of Lore, Dr. Boom, Ancient of War, it doesn't really matter what it is, as long as no 7 drop comes down next turn.
It's a pretty good Doomsayer tempo play, huh? Like, you're disrupting the turn 7 minion play that's so likely because of coin.
Yeah.
And the earlier you use it, the less likely they are to have Keeper, so the more likely it is to actually do something and go off for you.
But you have Blizzard to set up for, like, turn 8, Blizzard, Doomsayer, into Alex Trezor.
Yeah, and maybe you need to force something good like that to happen to actually win. So how important is it to save Big Game Hunter for an Alexstrasza?
No.
Not important, right?
You gotta hit him in the face.
I mean, if you get the BGH, it's a nice bonus, but usually you're gonna be in a tough spot right after Alex. If the Alex comes out and goes to your face, unless you've got Lotheb, it's pretty much over, and it won't matter whether or not the Alex ends up attacking you. You can probably stop it with taunts.
So do you play Explosive Sheep? Probably. Don't really see an alternative.
So play it and pass?
Right, you ping.
And ping, of course. But
yeah. Feels bad, but I guess...
You can also play the Explosive Sheep and Doomsayer.
Wow. The value.
That's...
That way the mage just kills the Explosive Sheep and then finishes off your Doomsayer. Full value.
But it's like if your hero powers the Explosive Sheep, he only has 4 more damage, but Doomsayer's at 5 HP, so he still has to spend a card on it.
And playing both seems like an overcommitment when you've got the Blizzard. But it's like such a crazy removal play. I mean, you could even stack it with like Twisting Nether out of Spellslinger at this point.
Okay, so now he goes for the Tempo Doomsayer again, slowing down the turn 7.
Oh, wow.
He's been slowing down the turn 7 minion as much as possible this game.
I mean, Oskaka's hand, like, the problem with Oskaka's hand right now is that he hasn't picked up Acolyte of Pain, he hasn't picked up Arcane Intellect, so his draw is very minor, and he's going to basically have to draw his answers really soon, because even though he can stall for time, he can only stall so much with one freeze.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's very little he can stall for. I mean, this turn looks okay, because you think the Doomsayer might go off. If it does, great. If it doesn't, then you can Blizzard. But you'd rather not have to resort to that just yet. He might have to play it very slowly and maybe take an entire turn of damage.
So Orange is going to silence this, right?
I think
saving the swipe?
I like swipe. Saving a swipe. You know your opponent has Ice Block, so there's a chance that at some point you need to trigger, to kill the freeze mage after the Ice Block, and he might have an Ice Barrier at that point. So swipe not that bad in this matchup. And I like Keeper just for an extra minion on board and to push more damage.
Yeah, maybe the idea behind keeping the Keeper is because
that's a pretty good card to get on turn 6.
Wow, yeah.
I mean, in this case, it's going to speed up the Alexstrasza play, but you still have to find better... The fact that you're forcing an answer is good, but you can get the counter-Emperor coin hero power, and that's going to put Oskaka in a weird spot, because right now, his removal for the Emperor involves a lot of commitment.
Oh, you don't do that.
You just let it live. I like leaving 5/5s up against Druid. Feels good, man.
So, Oskaka has 7 burn damage after Alexstrasza, so he's pretty far off from setting up lethals.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not super far off, but...
Alright, that's... So, maybe keeping the Keeper of the Grove had to do with the fact that, like, this Doomsayer didn't get much value. Like, if you just killed it, you did get a swipe away from you, but the cool thing is, if you see an Acolyte of Pain, and you've seen that Oskaka doesn't have draw, denying that card draw could put him in a really miserable spot afterwards. I'm not sure how much that's worth, but...
Yeah, it's useful for the second Doomsayer. It's also useful for unfreezing frozen minion
exactly.
To punch in.
Just go phase. Do you expect the Ancient of War? Because like you might think that there's a setup for Flamestrike, coming up, or a Blizzard. He's gonna heal his minion. No.
No, he's drawing. If you draw, you get the discount from Emperor on those two new cards.
Yeah, but.
And you're closer
you
towards
want
burst.
To heal after Alex Strasza.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it's useful as a heal Alex Strasza. You could have played Ancient of War. It's a much harder minion to like. This turn could be like a Flame Strike ping to clear the board, whereas Ancient of War would not die.
I think
that
you don't need more cards. So, like your hand right now is good enough. And
oh man,
after Alex Strasza is really
second
important.
Doomsayer. He's going for the Blizzard Doomsayer.
I mean, right now, if you're orange, I don't think you're scared of dying very soon, because the problem is Oskaka seems like he's been sitting on cards that he can't use. So either when he plays Alex, you're panicking, because maybe he's got the perfect, you know, double Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance follow-up. Or, alternatively, he's just whiffing completely, and he's trying to threaten you, so you kind of play it slowly. You play a bit defensively, but maybe not in panic mode. There's been no card draw from Oskaka at all, besides the Mad Scientist thinning the deck.
He's I'm surprised by this Alex. I thought the Blizzard Doomsayer was pretty tempting.
But he saw the Big Game Hunter already, so he knows that just the minion of Alex Strasza, the 8-8, is quite good to have. Slows your opponent down because he has to deal with it.
Yeah, the fact that you really can't do anything to this Alex without trading minions in is really problematic for Orange. But ultimately, you know, he gets to keep the Emperor if he wants it and get another round of discounts. It usually might not be the biggest deal, but it can have a little bit more impact later on when he needs to refill the board after a clear, if that ever happens.
We're trading our Emperor.
Interesting. Or playing Force.
Oh, yeah, playing Force too then.
I think it's going to be Force if he's going for that play. Oh, goodness. All right. He's flooding that board. That's interesting. If he.
I thought we could have put a taunt in the way and just believed in that to stick.
Right.
Yeah, like the sort of Agent of War.
Double Fireball would have killed you, though, because you could ping on top with the discounted Fireball, I think. So he Fireballs the... I mean, the Ancient of War would live, so I guess he'd be fine. Oh, wow.
So that's 13 damage over there.
And there's a lot of like card war left in this deck. He didn't throw any Acolytes, he didn't throw any Intellects, so there's such a high chance that he draws Burst or card war to the next two turns.
Yeah, and there's no healing for Orange right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, why is there no healing?
Because it needed to be drawn.
No, he had one.
He had one, he chose to play it.
Yeah, of course. He did. You have to draw cards, man.
No, you don't. Not against Freeze Mage.
Get all the cards.
I thought it was pretty reasonable to draw there.
Yeah.
It didn't work out in this case.
With the absence of card draw from the Mage, I feel like your draw lets you like pressure him even more.
Yeah.
So that you're forcing him to play really clunky, you know, draw turns when you're already on the board. I feel like that draw was definitely...
It was sort of like drawing three cards, because you draw two cards to get Emperor right away, which is
right,
an innervate
exactly.
on them.
Yeah. Oh,
but
man.
You had an Ancient of War, which was a really reasonable play and makes you safe to heal. I think that against Freeze Mage, this is the superior play.
Oh my god. All right, that is really clutch for Oskaka.
Now, do you ping the Shredder before you Blizzard? Because
there's
like one burn spell's lethal either way.
Ping the face.
Well, okay, you have 13 in hand, right? Oh. 14 with the ping.
Okay, but this has
16, so
Ancient
like,
of Lore, then Fireball makes difference, right?
Well, those are like both one-ofs.
I mean, it is
the one of Lore,
it
you
is
have
true,
to hit the one
though,
of Fireball.
But the thing is, the one-ofs actually add up to a higher percentage chance than the Shredder.
Yeah, I guess you're saying you're just not dealing with this board long-term. You're really just all in on killing the guy.
I think that's what you'd feel right now if you're Skaka. I mean, what would you be looking for out of the Shredder? So there's the Sheave, there's... Like, assuming you're not going for a Hail Mary and you just want to kill whatever's inside. Like, is the 2-drop really that big of a deal?
Yeah, probably not. So it's pretty close either way.
Yeah,
you can definitely see,
like,
just hit him in the face.
I like pinging the Shredder, but you also have to consider the drops that could come out.
Unfortunately for Oskaka, that's...
Could have been Wrathguard, by the way. That would be interesting.
Could have been Lorewalker, sure, that would be interesting.
Oh.
Could have been...
There's not room for both Boombots here.
Yeah, so do you opt simply to not play it? It's just like, it's a 7 mana... Like, it's a 7-7, that is, against a mage that already used 2 Blizzards and doesn't seem to have much in the way of AoE. Is that the top deck to rule them all? There's probably something there. Oh, my goodness.
Wow. We just keep
stalling. I mean, it just starts one turn, doesn't make a difference.
So, do you ping something, or do you just let them not refill the board any further?
No, you definitely don't clear a minion.
Yeah.
You don't want him to play low sap.
Yeah. Do you Fireball face this turn? Cross Nova, yes. Fireball face, ping face?
I think so, because you have... Acolytes and Arcane Intellect left, so you might not have the mana.
What about Pyroblast? Do we Frostbolt Ice Lance face because of that? Then we lose Ice Lance.
That's
no,
a
no, we
good
don't.
Point.
We save that for Antonidas. For Antonidas
or for also the second Ice Lance.
Yeah. I mean, I felt like Oskaka had almost no way to win, but just because of the way that he keeps just getting the AoE, that may not be the Arcane of Pain or the Arcane Intellect.
Every turn he's drawing towards potential lethal here, right?
Right. And Ice Block's also buying him another turn later. Oh my goodness.
More redraws.
There we go. Oskaka with the Flame Strike. Wait.
He's one off.
Wait, that's how you actually think phase.
So
you said it makes no difference. It's a ley light. Barely.
Oh no.
He's one off because he pinged the Shredder, huh?
Absolutely true. That's absolutely absurd. True.
You still just go for it now, I think. You need to draw with it.
Yeah. You have to play the Thalnos to draw, and then once you're doing that, you go for the Frostbolt Ice Lance.
Probably. The fun part about it is that your opponent can't silence your Thalnos, because in order to play a Keeper, he needs to get rid of one of his minions, and the only minion you can trade into is a Thalnos. There's no way of getting silenced.
Well, if he draws Wrath.
Okay, but...
But yeah.
That's a really interesting decision that Oskaka's got to make, but the draw looks
like... But I think we might just Flamestrike this turn.
I feel like Flamestrike is kind of okay. I mean, you are guaranteed to take a lot of damage, though, and you're freeing it up for the combo plays.
Oh.
Yeah, speeding it. Oh, wow. Ooh. Yeah, that looks like game.
Oh, right, this way. So opponent can't play a minion.
There's no way he can trade. And now there's no Lothab at all.
That's why he is a world champion. Why we are just casting.
You know what? I can't even figure out if you're like half sarcastic half the time, but that's the
question. Oh, no, I would never go for sarcasm.
No, no never. I know. So,
we're serious.
You're not like that. This is too serious of a place to be. Serious story cup.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So Oskaka wins the very unfavorable matchup.
Oh no, it's not unfavored. Let's be real.
I think it's changed a lot.
It's the world champion playing freeze match against a decent player,
Orange
but not the world champion.
Orange is the returning champion for this tournament. He won the last one.
Yeah, he did.
Okay, but he's not the world champion.
Eh.
Like the world champion of Sea Story Cup's last iteration. For sure.
And now it goes into Freeze Mage versus Paladin.
And that should be, like, we keep talking about that, but yesterday there was an upset where, I forget who it was that was playing.
It was Tice playing, but Tice isn't the world champion. Got him.
Right, Tice was playing Freeze Mage against, was it Frodan?
Yes, it was Frodan.
So Frodan ended up beating Tice with Secret Paladin. I don't know if Orange is bringing Secret or mid-range.
Let's find out.
Yeah, I have actually no idea, so we'll see when the game starts. If Oskaka is getting taken off guard the same way Tice did, then things could get pretty ugly. But
you'd rather be playing Secret Pound. It is Secret Pound.
All right, so it turns out that it is.
But the Explosive Sheep is going to be a nice card for Oskaka in this matchup, right? Maybe you don't have to keep the Frostbolt since you have Explosive Sheep Blue Hoarder.
Explosive Sheep.
I mean, what do you even look for? Your hand is so good at this point.
Yeah. I mean, Scientist improves it. Accolade, Arcane, Electro, okay.
I guess I'm going to Doomsday.
Wow, it did improve. That's insane.
It improved perfectly, pretty much. Frostbolt is one of, like, this entire hand for the Mage, the only thing it's missing is a follow-up Arcane, Intellect, and Accolade, but that can definitely come out, because you've got Loot Hoarder to give you an extra draw, so we've got about 3 draws before you even get to consider that.
Meanwhile, Orange is missing all the early game pressure, so his next 2 top decks are very important.
He did get Noble Sacrifice, though. Very, very high pressure card against the Mad Scientist.
Yeah.
Absolutely crushing.
All right, so he missed on turns 1 and 2, but 3, 4, 5, 6 are going to be all right.
Yeah. And then 7, probably, just based on what we know.
Yeah.
It's always like that. Never one.
What about the 8?
The other. The 8 is kind of a weapon guy. I'm not sure what his name is.
So probably Loot Hoarder here?
I think you might hero power instead.
Really?
Okay. I mean, what that means is that your turn 3 would consist of... Because you want to probably Explosive Sheep at some point.
I do. When I have card draw for turn 3.
The Loot Hoarder walks in to muster for battle weapon, but it gives you a better chance to have a better turn 3 play. Probably want a Sheep ping on 4. Maybe sometimes you just develop the Sheep here and don't attack and don't...
Then you might just... I think we would see Sheep come down here.
Yeah.
Oh, nope.
Yeah.
No. I'm not the world champion.
Okay.
Oh my god, I have a really dank joke, but I'd rather not.
Sami Chao is not what you want to draw against a Freeze Mage.
I mean, it is a card that... Like, if ever there's a board sweep and you've seen enough of them, it can be like just the extra late-game garbage that you Blessing of Kings. Mm-hmm. Like, it can be used with Blessing of Kings in this matchup quite well, I find.
That's a good point.
But usually, it's not something that you want to play as just a 1-mana 2-3. And, you know, we did see a double Blessing of Kings list from Frodan yesterday. I'm not sure if Orange is playing something along those lines. Like, just say Intect, the Frodan list, quite well, I have to say. And I wonder if, you know, some people took a page from that book and maybe put more Kings in their decks.
Skaka has a lot of burn damage. He has Emperor into Alex with, what is that, 17 damage after that?
17 damage with the Fireballs.
So he's got a turn 9 lethal setup here, right? Some point he plays Emperor, turn 8 he plays Alexstrasza, turn 9, kill you.
Yeah, but does he
live that long?
I mean, I think he... Oh, yeah, that's going to be rough. He does have the Ice Block set up, but I don't even know if he gets there without a freeze right now. Because he gets bopped next turn? No, not quite. He's going to be pretty close, but not quite.
So, 4 secrets went up for Orange. We've seen Noble Sacrifice and Avenge in hand. So, probably either Competitive Spirit or Repentance is missing.
So we might see a... you kind of expect the Repentance. So Doomsday is not that great, but with a Competitive Spirit, your opponent can't proc your Ice Block.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
Just play Emperor.
I mean, you're getting proc'd and you have no AoE. You can't even play Alex. You can play Flamestrike for 6, but that's not going to do much for you because you're still getting punished by all the secrets triggering, including Avenge and Redemption. So
I think Orange doesn't have Repentance because he attacked with that weapon last turn.
I mean, even if, like, let's assume I'm Orange here, right? And I don't have Repentance. I still go for your face with block, right? Because I get the Redemption to trigger on your turn, and then I get the Belcher Slime, which is enough to pop your block afterwards, unless you put it down. And then I've got the follow-up Tyrion with the Challenger. I think Skaka recognizes there's no way he's going to get it done unless he goes all in on the Doomsayer. And in this case, I think he's doing pretty well. The draw to punish. That is rough. That is rough.
What was he saving that last Ice Lance for?
The face, the fireball, maybe like another turn of freeze after a flame strike. I don't know. When you flame strike the challenger, let's say, sometimes you can get like another turn of freeze. So you can trigger Redemption pretty mildly with a ping.
Yeah, but
your heal bot still does
procs Avenge as well.
Yeah, it just gives 3 more damage on the board.
This is pretty rough.
There's got to be... Okay, wait. What about a Fireball Ice Lance line of play? So Fireball the... you Fireball the Ooze, then you ping... Nah, this is...
You could Fireball the 7-4, and then it avenges the Ooze, and you Ice Lance that, but...
I mean, if the Avenge falls on the 7-4, you could find a way to kill it later. I just don't know of a way for Skaka to get out of this cleanly. Is there a world in which you go for the Emperor Hail Mary, where you just top deck some kind of Ice Block follow-up, and then you stall? Can you even pull it off ever? There's not enough burn in that deck. Yeah. Not enough burn.
He went pretty close to all in on that on the Doomsayer going off.
All right.
Orange top deck the Kings to deal with it.
He's forcing his opponent to have 1 damage from hand because right now there's only 12 on this board for Orange. And if he doesn't pick it up, oh my God.
Every time.
Unbelievable. But now the question is, does Orange pop the block?
Yeah.
Or does he kill the Emperor?
That's no way
he's got
to
go for the block. Yeah, he's got to go for the block.
Got to
pop it. 100%. But
you saw both Ice Lances, you know, his face is probably not getting frozen, so even if there's a Frost Nova, True Server can still kill the mage next turn.
Yeah, he's got to be like on Ice Block with... He's got to have everything perfectly, and even everything perfectly still gives you the long game. When you're looking at your hand, there's almost no way the mage is able to kill you through this.
And you certainly don't play the Zombie Chow. Not reason not the hero power.
That Zombie Chow is a good card.
It's all right.
Why is it in his deck, then, if he doesn't want to play it?
Probably for turn 1, I'm thinking.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Maybe other matchups.
And here I was. I mean, with a Frostbolt to face, all you do is stall. Flamestrike doesn't even wipe the board, so you're pretty much dead, no matter what you do. And Skaka does go down to Orange.
What a match. I mean, the esports were so real. Just every time. Like, the Blade Flurry top deck.
Not enough.
The 1-12
Boombot. Nothing beats the Woke against Druid game.
The Shredder shenanigans were off the charts. Unlike
yeah, and the Deadly Poison into Flurry on the first match with the Skull Cup back to back. I feel like the amount of esports in this series was more than probably something like I've seen in the recent memory.
I've been just casting all the best matches. Like the previous one I was casting was like Elky going
against
MC Tech. Into VGH Dr. Boom two games in a row.
That was champion and a Giga.
All right, Orange, congratulations on your win against the world champion. By extension, we determined that you are now the world champion. So
that's how it works. That's very cool.
Yeah, you just dethroned him straight up. Now, how much, like on a scale of 1 to about 23, right? How many esports were there in this series?
There were a bit too much esports for my taste.
But on a scale of 1 to 23.
On a scale from 1 to 23,
yeah, pick a letter.
Like 25?
5 to 23?
Oh, 25.
Okay.
Out of 23.
Okay, 25 out of out of 20. That sounds about right. I think we can agree on that.
Yeah, literally off the charts.
Yeah, absolutely insane.
Yeah.
Well played.
They were on both sides. It's not like just you. But,
right.
Like, he could have, in that last game, he could have ice lanced your acidic Swampoos, and then he drew the kings to kill his Doomsayer. Right.
He had an extra ice lance just to freeze the ooze, but
I see.
And
yeah.
So you got the kings, or the true silver and kings were both like ouse that could.
I got kings first, then true silver.
Yeah.
Right, but he had the ice lance, to freeze the ooze. But you got in the end, he didn't use it and got punished because his doomsayer got removed with one of the only two outs. And if he'd used the ice lance, I think he would have cleared the board.
But would he have won? Because then he doesn't have enough burst left to kill him after Alex Trezor.
Exactly, yeah.
Kind of needed the first goal to kill him with Ice Lance after Alex Trezor with Fireball.
Yeah, I agree with Six. If it doesn't have enough burst, like the Tyrion will just be way too much. If it can't kill me.
It was actually really intense. Like the matches, the draws were good for both players. But, Boombots, as it turns out, can win games.
Well, the Shredders, I think, is like the highlight of that. That was... I don't know how much luck I wasted on that one turn.
But it's good, though, because you're in around a 16. This is probably like one of the good places to get some luck. Now, I'm going to wish you good luck on your next match.
Thank you.
You still have to make it out of the group.
Yep.
And, Oskaka's there with Frodan. Mm. So you will be facing off against Frodan, potentially.
It's a scary group.
Sorry?
It's a scary group.
Yeah, Frodan beat the group of death.
I really want to play Frodan. Just like he's costed me so many times, but I've never really played against him. So I would like to play Frodan because of that.
Yeah, and if the worst comes to shove and you end up losing, we'll have you cast around like the next round where he plays. So you can always diss him there. Yeah, good plays. All right, that being said, guys, we'll take a short break and we'll be back with the next match in a few minutes. It's C-Story.